cinema, et cetera, and it was given once a week by Hagman-Ugin. And basically, a lot of kids took that class because they thought they could hang around for 2 or 3 hours on Thursday and relax and watch movies. Yeah. No, no, no. So by the second semester, that was pretty strong, and there was kind of weeded out. And then in the second year, you took two other courses, and by the third year, you were able to begin to make a short film.
Mnuchin obviously was a great influence on you, wasn't he?
Yes.
Tremendous.
Yeah.
It would take much more than a bigger boat. Making Jaws on page to screen. Tomorrow at 8, only on Bravo.
Before Charles Schwab advises me to make an investment, they ask me what I would like.
They ask me what my objectives are and what I want to do.
I think they really focus on understanding my needs before they give me advice.
The advice that they give me is objective. It isn't driven by investment banking.
We get some honest information and we get answers.
Charles Schwab really is a company I feel like I can trust.
This year, investors moved more than $30 billion to Charles Schwab. Come see why.
Was it a date? The plot thickens. And I'm wearing a pink linen jacket and white leather
shoes. It's Patrick.
Many moods, many occasions. One line always connects. Woodbridge by Robert Mondavi.
Season, send a card.
I'm smiling now because I remembered you.
They'll never forget you remembered.
Can you love someone too much? Well, you can try. The 1-carat princess cut diamond ring, just $4.99. Exclusively at Zales, the diamond store.
This year, make yourself.
You're about to witness a graphic representation of what internet access is like with a dial-up connection. That took forever. Now this is what high-speed internet access is like with a cable modem. Don't blink. It's fast. With a cable modem, there's never a busy signal, you're always connected, plus service is guaranteed. And most importantly, it's really, really fast.
Go dashing to the phone for a jolly carpet sale with samples in your home.
It's like a fairy tale.
New carpet that's installed by the holiday.
Interest free for 12 whole months before you have to pay.
Oh, E-M-P-I-R-E, Empire's on the way.
You can save a lot on carpet if you call today.
Hey!
Save big on carpet installed in time for Christmas. Guaranteed.
Thank you for with brand new carpet. Just dial 1-800. Get a free gift with your carpet.
588-23-HO-HO.
Bravo has a night that you won't flip over.
No flipping.
Macy, thanks for doing the show. I really appreciate it.
I'm glad it's back on the air.
One full night of the best of the Larry Sanders Show.
Both hoity and toity.
With your favorite stars.
And I've never done a talk show in my life.
Favorite castmates.
God damn it! When were you going to tell me?
And favorite lines.
Hey now.
No flipping.
The Larry Sanders Show Marathon. A night of no flipping.
That's hilarious.
Friday, December 27th, beginning at 9:30 on Bravo.
Now look how quickly we come in this life to movies, to real movies.
Yeah.
What's a nice girl like you doing in a place like this?
Well, that title was just a reference to movie cliches. That was just a desire to put something on film that had an energy and a humor to it. That really came, the humor came through early television, I think, and had to do more with Ernie Kovacs.
God.
Yeah. It came from skit comedy, really, and it employed. It was really a sense like an exercise. I tried to do the film in terms of every camera trick imaginable, which came from cartoons and also from the French New Wave and the Italian New Wave films that were happening at the time.
It's not just you, Murray.
That was an attempt a year later, taking something that I kind of knew in a way, the area I grew up in and people in that area. But I also combined it with movies from Hollywood, particularly Warner Brothers. The gritty films they made in the 30s.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a Fugitive from Chain Gang, but mainly the Raoul Walsh's pictures, the Roaring 20s.
Didn't your mother appear in it?
Oh, my mother's in it, yeah, serving. Well, that we drafted my mother into the picture, my father, too. We drafted them all. We actually shot some of it in my grandmother's apartment.
Our students here are earning their master's degrees at New School University, and I know that you continued your education at NYU, did you not, toward a master's degree?
Yes, actually, Haig Manoogian, they went into a master class, in a way, and it was only about four or five students. And I started to work on what I wanted to. I wanted to do a feature. The only thing is, I didn't know how to. If I had anything to say, number one, and if I had it to say, how could I transform it into film and image and dialogue, etc. And it took me 3 or 4 years to be able to do that.
This evolved over a period of time. I think the film "Who's That Knocking at My Door?"
It certainly did.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
What did you shoot it on?
Well, my friend Richard Cole at the time, a young film student who was really wonderful with camera. We got talked into doing, this would have been the first 35mm film at NYU.
Right.
And the only thing was, I was used to moving, you know, what the French New Wave and the Italian New Wave had, and what John Cassavetes and Shirley Clarke were shooting with, I mean, after she did Connection, it was the Arriflex.
Yeah.
You know, or the Eclair. And you were moving the camera. It was kind of handheld, but you don't have to do it handheld. You can put it on an LMX Spider. You can move it. You can have 42 different compositions in an 8-minute shot, you know, if you moved it correctly or as you liked. And so what happened was that we got, in the first couple of months of shooting that particular film, we used the wrong equipment. It was a Mitchell BNC.
Oh my God.
Yeah, and I brought it down to
the booth.
Yeah, literally, it's bigger than this platform. Yeah. And I brought it down to the old neighborhood, and I had this little storefront that was supposed to be an after-hours place, and the camera was bigger than the place inside. It was killing the actors. It was killing the whole feeling of the picture. And ultimately, we just, I edited together what I had at the end of the year. It was 1965. And it was shown at the NYU end of the year screening. It was a disaster. And it sort of lay dormant for about a year or two until Haig Manoogian came up and said, listen, why don't we shoot the scenes that you should have done, certain scenes between what turned out to be Zena Bethune and Harvey Keitel, explaining some of that, intercutting it with the 35, and ultimately, that was the film that was shown at Chicago Film Festival.
Zena Bethune and I acted together on The Guiding Light.
Uh-huh.
The film has some eroticism in it. There's some nudity, there's some sex.
Oh, yes, that's a very important point. We showed the picture in Chicago. I didn't go. Haig went and they showed it. Haig called up and said, listen, we have a guy who wants to distribute the film, finally. The only thing is, and this you have to understand, was that there was a new freedom in cinema in 68. In everything, yeah. And so Haig said, listen, you want the picture released? It has to have a nude scene. I flew Harvey over to Amsterdam, and I shot this scene in Amsterdam.
No kidding.
Found a loft, looked just like the Bowery. Yeah. And so we came back. I brought it in. I didn't declare it at customs. I just had it in my coat. And it was cut to... It was cut to the end by the doors. And took it in, we looked at it, it was pretty good. We said, okay, fine, I had done the storyboards and everything. And Haig said, where do we put it? I said, I don't know, so we just dropped in the middle of one scene. That was the kind of, I mean, there was no structure, there was no narrative.
It was sort of his fantasy.
Yeah, it was a fantasy thing, and it was pretty, it's not my favorite but it's the film. But it really, Who's That Knocking was really a learning process. You have to understand, too, that a student film at that time, it isn't like where you have a schedule. You shot when you had the camera. So I'd have to call Harvey and say, we're shooting on the weekend. He says, you know, and Harvey was a court stenographer. He was trying to earn a living.
Yeah.
He really got mad after a while. And he got his hair cut. I said, why did you cut your hair? The scene is a continuity. He said, I have a life. You guys are crazy. You keep shooting this thing on the weekends. The only thing was the haircut. He went in one scene. It's the same scene. He goes in one door and he comes in, his hair's cut. Just to show you what a great storyteller. Nobody noticed.
How did you come upon Boxcar Bertha?
Well, what happened was I came back from Europe, and I worked for a little while at NYU as an instructor.
Yeah.
I used to work for the Maisel brothers, and I used to hold, when they started doing color, I had to hold a light for them, because they were doing cinema verite, you know?
Yeah.
And I was editing some documentaries with him, and with Thelma Schoonmaker, too, is when I met her there. And
yeah.
What eventually happened was that we were going to do a rock and roll revival film. Something else came ahead of it. And he said, why don't we just go and test this theory, you know, and shoot this thing called Woodstock. That's happening. I was like an assistant director in a way, and then did some of the editing on that film. And that got me known by certain people in Warner Brothers. And I was taken out to Warner Brothers in 1970. And while I was out there for those first 4 weeks, one of my agents at William Morris at the time took me over to see Roger Corman. He said, would you be interested in doing a sort of a sequel to Bloody Mama? And I said, yeah, costumes and, yeah, the 1930s, I would be, yeah. It was called Boxcar Bertha. And we had Barbara Hershey, David Carradine, and Barry Primus. Those are the people I had to make it with. I became rather obsessive with, based on those old storyboards I did when I was a kid, I decided that, and seeing these Russian films that I liked very much, and Italian and the French films, and I was designing the shot. So the cheaper the film, the less money I had to make the film, the better prepared I had to be. That's what I felt. And I drew 500 shots and showed it to him. He said, can I see your notes? And I looked at him, he went through it, he looked at the 10, 20 pages, goes, that's enough, you'll be fine.
And didn't Corman have his certain obligatory requirements also about violence and nudity?
Yeah, I mean, we loved Roger Corman films. I love the horror films, particularly the Poe films. And so when he was there, when I read the script and I did some work on the script, he liked that. And he said, now, Marty, what you have to understand is every 15 pages, there has to be nudity or the suggestion thereof. Suggestion.
December to Remember sales event.
It's beautiful.
Mom, open me.
You'll find incredible values whether you buy or lease.
We did it.
Go on. December to Remember sales event.
Hey, what you got?
Missing it would definitely spoil the surprise.
Come on, let's go.
See your Lexus dealer.
Florida's natural premium orange juice is made just from our fresh oranges. Not from concentrate. And it's the only leading brand owned by a small co-op of growers. Since we own the land, the trees, and the company, only our personal best goes into every carton. Florida's natural. It's as close to the grower as you can get.
Retirement plans from the Principal Financial Group can prepare you for almost anything.
Yeah, you got it.
Retiring!
Retiring! With the Principal, we're the nation's 401k leader. We offer mutual funds, annuities, and rollover IRAs, which leads to a secure, happy retirement.
Ted, how'd you do it?
Planning.
For 120 years, the Principal Financial Group, we understand what you're working for.
This one's been in my family for generations. This was made by Marie Antoinette. Ah, my favorite. It's from England.
Terry's premium chocolate balls make a whacking good holiday gift. Try new peppermint and pure milk chocolate.
Happy holidays. Watch the snowflakes falling. A harmony creates a peaceful grace on earth.
Bravo wishes you a happy holiday season and a bright new year.
I believe that Who's That Knocking at My Door was the second of a trilogy that began with Jerusalem, Jerusalem at NYU and concluded with a rather important film, not only for you, but for a great many films that followed it. And it was called Mean Streets. Yeah. What was its evolution?
Well, I think what was happening was in the 4 years that I was pulling together Who's That Knocking? Don't forget, there's part of you, too, that one has to balance out wanting to express yourself with cinema and be alive in telling stories with camera and actors, but also balance it with the need to be famous. There was that when I saw Bertolucci at that time. I wanted that, but I had to go my own way, and the work has to be more important than being famous or being known. And I over a period of years, I had to learn that. But the problem was that at that time, I was just possessed with it, and I went too hard and too fast. And I'll never forget the New York Film Festival has always been great to me. When we submitted Who's That Knocking, they wrote back a note saying, you're living aesthetically beyond your means. So, I mean, you really had a lot to learn about life and people. I was burning, but I didn't have. And so out of that, and also the incredible knowledge I learned from Corman, and that Corman was another university, combining that with what I couldn't get on film in Who's That Knocking, what I wanted to say, and this, what was really eating away at me, my life, my memories and my emotional makeup, which had to do more with my family and my father and his family as his brothers, was eventually to find its way into Mean Streets, and also about myself and my old friends, of covering a period from 60 to 63 when I was sort of split between NYU and reading Henry James and hanging out in after-hour clubs on the weekend.
Yeah.
You know.
How long did it take you to write it?
Oh, 6 years on and off. My friend Martik Martin helped me a lot. He was an NYU student, and he would help work on the structure and that sort of thing.
For whom did you write the role of Charlie?
Harvey. He was the alter ego, there's no doubt about it. We came very close, and he's quite extraordinary, Harvey.
In other words, you were writing about yourself, so it was autobiographical.
Yes. Yeah. First of all, I didn't think it would get made. Then I thought when it was getting made that it would never be really released. I just thought if anybody would ever want to know what it was really like with Sicilian Americans downtown, 40 years in the future, they could look at two or three scenes, one of them being the improvisation between De Niro and Keitel in the back room earlier in the film. They could get a sense of what it really is, because De Niro knew those people. Harvey would hang around with me, so he knew a lot of the people we were making the film about. And so that became something I thought that would just be eventually shown almost anthropologically. I never really thought it was going to be, you know.
You were wrong.
Yeah.
As the movie begins, we hear a voice in darkness. Whose mm-hmm. voice is it?
That's my voice. And
do you remember what you said?
Yeah. Is he make up for your sins at home and in the streets, I think? Is it?
Yeah, he says, you don't make up for your sins in church.
Yeah.
Do it in the streets, you do it at home. All the rest is BS.
It's bullshit. And you know it.
In one of the most memorable shots in the film, Charlie holds his hand over a votive candle.
Yeah.
Well, have you ever done that?
It's kind of a funny thing, but it, out of context, it sounds somewhat horrendous. But within context, because you had a balance of certain kinds of teachers and certain priests or nuns who came in to speak specially, and there were some who would give a mission. And then by the third day, the sermons got really serious, and you got into hellfire to a certain extent, and you put your finger over a flame and see how long you can hold it there. So imagine the pains of hell.
When Harvey was here, this is what he said.
The dogma of the different religions, in my sense, the Jewish one, his sense, the Catholic one, the prohibitions, the hopes, the taboos. We had these questions, we were struggling against these very restrictive emotional criteria. Mm-hmm. We felt something else was present, something else was there we needed to get at, and we've been trying ever since.
Agree with him?
Yeah, no, I tell myself we go right to the heart of it. I mean, it's just simply like being the same person at times.
One of your hallmarks is certainly the color palette that you choose. It was evident very early in Mean Streets. The bar scenes are all in red.
Red, yeah.
They're red. Another of your hallmarks is the use of slow motion, certainly visible in this movie. What does slow motion do for you? What is it meant to do to us?
I think for me at that time, there was something about the deliberately slowing down of everyday actions, and also the aesthetic of slow motion, the movement, watching the movements. And
graceful.
Like dance.
It is a dance, and also it makes us think in slow motion. Mm-hmm. Who plays the assassin at the end of the film?
Oh, I did. Yeah.
Why?
I had to do it out of economy, and also it was my 30th birthday that night. I
said,
I gave myself a part to shoot those aspects of myself, which I was trying to get through, which I was trying to absorb and get past, you know, but it didn't work.
Worked in the film, you were a very good assassin.
Oh, thanks.
Marty, of course, around the world is considered an auteur. And one of the reasons, of course, is that there are so many hallmarks in his films that are distinguishable from anybody else's. One of them, of course, is the way you use music. Now, you were using it that way in this film. You were using period rock and roll.
Yes.
You're accenting with songs.
Absolutely, and the songs were all pretty much planned way beforehand. For example, when Keitel wakes up from that nightmare in the beginning, he wakes up and he goes to look in the mirror, which is something out of, really, I love Albert Finney in Saturday Night, Sunday Morning, looking in the mirror. Remember? And he has his voiceover, said, "What am I?" Mm-hmm. And it's so beautiful. And he touches his face, and then he goes to lie back down on the bed, and his head, it cuts in three cuts very close to the pillow as his head hits, and those are the first three beats of Be My Baby by the Ronettes, Phil Spector sound. And that's all planned. That's all planned out.
And then you edit in the room to the music when you get into the editing?
Yeah.
When Alan Burstyn was here, we talked about Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore. I believe that Ellen was responsible for you directing that film. How did it happen?
Well, she was looking, she had just done The Exorcist, and Warner Brothers was very high on her. She was excellent in the film. Then Francis Coppola had just seen Mean Streets, and he told her, "You got to see this kid."
I'm told that when Ellen met with you, she said, "What do you know about women?"
I said, "Absolutely nothing, but I'd hope to learn."
Ellen Burstyn won an Oscar for her performance in this film. She was one of the creators of this school. Mm-hmm. She's taught our students here. She was one of the first guests in that chair, and she is today a co-president of the Actors Studio with Harvey Keitel and Al Pacino. I think that in that film, her range is astonishing.
Oh, yeah. We had a great time with that because she's really tough, fearless, and was open to anything with a great sense of humor.
She said, "Of all the directors I've worked with, Marty is best at providing the environment where actors can do their best work. He'll say, 'Okay, we know what the scene is about, now what's it going to be?' And the actors will start improvising." Do you like to use improvisation a great deal?
Yes. In Alice, we did a great deal of it, and it was really influenced from Cassavetes after seeing Shadows and being around John Cassavetes a lot. I was really influenced by his life that he put on screen, but also in certain moments of American movies that Hawks created, and also John Ford created a certain camaraderie of the family in John Ford films.
And there's a little girl in the film who plays the friend of Ellen's son. Who is
Jodie Foster.
Jesus.
Jodie Foster, when she came in the room for the audition, sat down. I said, "Where you been?" "So I've been working on some commercials." I said, "Oh, yeah? Yeah." So this kid is tough.
Ellen won the Academy Award for this picture. Who accepted her Academy Award?
She asked me to accept it that night. She was doing Same Time Next Year, I think it was.
Yeah.
And I was sort of embarrassed. She asked me to thank myself. So I did.
They seek perfection, but why? They defy gravity, but how? They're from all over the world, but who are they? This January, the mystery is finally revealed in Bravo's new reality series, Cirque du Soleil, Fire Within. Premieres Monday, January 6th at 9 with back-to-back episodes.
The things that really matter keep passing through my mind. And this crazy world keeps turning, but I know I got to find a way to stay connected.
One of the best gifts I ever got was having a mom who turned out to be my best friend. Merry Christmas, Mom.
I'm smiling now because I remember.
This holiday, send a card. They'll never forget you remembered.
Charles Schwab is proud to present a preview of next week's Inside the Actor's Studio.
It wasn't working, and Ridley came over to me and just whispered in my ear, he goes, "Close your mouth." Because, you know, they don't look very fierce like this. Rafe is my favorite leading man. He's exceedingly generous. It's his love scene. He's like, oh, what are we gonna do here? How do we... I'll take my pants off.
Julianne Moore, Inside the Actor Studio, hosted by James Lipton. Questions and actors. Next Sunday on Bravo. Brought to you by Charles Schwab. There's never been a better time for Charles Schwab.
I don't think there was a question of whether we were getting good advice or not from our old broker. We weren't getting advice.
My old broker, unless I called him, he would never call me.
For a lot of years, I just tolerated that type of treatment, and then I decided I would move my money to Schwab.
This year, investors moved more than $30 billion to Charles Schwab.
I think Charles Schwab's actually almost the opposite of a Wall Street firm.
They treat me with respect.
Well, I think they just get it.
Come see why there's never been a better time for Charles Schwab.
Guess what? You're not going to believe what I'm going to do. I'm going rock climbing.
We can turn you on to loads of TV channels.
I was watching this program on TV.
We can turn you on to lightning fast internet connections.
Oh, they have this website.
We can turn you on to local and long distance phone service with all the features you're looking for. But we know there are times when you want to escape the everyday.
Come on.
I'm out climbing. Leave a message.
And we can help you with that too. AT&T Broadband. Cable television, high-speed cable internet, digital phone service. The power of three.
If your passion is coffee, your pleasure will be Javalia. You won't find Javalia on any corner, yet it's within arm's reach. Call 1-800-299-7017 and we'll deliver two boxes of our exquisite European coffee for just $14.95. And now you'll receive our exclusive thermal carafe coffee maker, free. If you enjoy Javalia, we'll send you more, automatically. Call 1-800-299-7017.
Epi.
Bravo has a night that you won't flip over.
No flipping.
Macy, thanks for doing the show. I really appreciate it.
I'm glad it's back on the air.
One full night of the best of the Larry Sanders Show.
Both hoity and toity.
With your favorite stars.
And I've never done a talk show in my life.
Favorite castmates.
God damn it! When were you going to tell me?
And favorite lines.
Hey now.
No flipping.
The Larry Sanders Show Marathon. A night of no flipping.
That's hilarious.
Friday, December 27th, beginning at 9:30 on Bravo.
With Marty's fifth professional effort, he quite simply created a landmark American movie. Tell us, please, what was the genesis of Taxi Driver?
In Los Angeles at the time, we became a group of people who started getting friendly. We all began to meet at different houses and places. And the man who took me around most of the time was Brian De Palma. Brian said, you have to meet this Paul Schrader. He's fantastic. Schrader's amazing, amazing. And he said, this is a wonderful script. And he said, you should do it. You should do this, Taxi Driver. And I would sort of hang around Schrader and sort of give me a look like, yeah, come back when you know. Sort of like, get away from me. And I was tenacious. I was like a bull. I'd go to every party. I'd go to, you know, I was really a bore. And it was just impossible to be around. I'd just done a Roger Corman film. And I would be friendly with all of them, Michael and Julia Phillips, who later produced the picture. And as Julia Phillips, as she said, you know, come back later when you've done something more than Boxcar Bertha and grow a few inches. You know, I came back. I kept coming back. And then one day we showed a rough cut of Mean Streets to Schrader, and he called up Phillips's, and they came. But it had to do also with the Phillips's being very strong, very powerful with the kind of films they wanted to make, films of vision in Hollywood at the time. The main thing was actually because De Niro would be in it, too. It was a team, in a way. That's how we got the money for it.
I understand from Bob that you all cut your salaries to the bone in order to do it.
Oh, salary? No, I don't even remember a salary.
Really?
No, I mean, I'm sure they paid me something, but see, that was the thing that always took advantage of me because I was so crazy to make these movies, you know. And that's when Mike Ovitz finally came into the picture in 1986. He tapped me on the shoulder and said, you know, you can get paid for this. I said, yeah? They're not going to take it away? He said, no, Marty, you can get paid. Sometimes.
The titles of this movie begin with a taxi emerging from a cloud of steam issuing from the bowels of New York. And it ends, the titles end with a long, extreme close-up of Travis's eyes, looking slowly right and left. Are you establishing the film's point of view at that point?
Yeah, that's a good point, because what I knew immediately, the film had to be, the only way it could be told was through his eyes and his perception only. That was the key thing. And so the eyes, which actually come from movement of eyes in Tales of Hoffman, of Robert Helpman, as playing the devil in Tales of Hoffman, he would do these incredible things with his eyes, you know. Yeah. So, I mean, they're long leaps, but those are the images that stay in your mind. You see, no, it reminds me of that, but if we do it at 36 frames, it might get this strange feeling the way Helpman had in Paul Pressburger's film, you know. And then the other thing, too, is music was very important in that film, in that normally I couldn't conceive of music in the traditional Hollywood fashion. It had to be the music the way that I grew up around. But the only thing with Travis, the problem with Travis, that he was cut off from people. He didn't listen to the radio. So then I said, well, the only man who could do this score is Bernard Herrmann.
The best of them all, in my view.
Yeah.
So you had Hitchcock's composer?
Yeah. I called him up. He was living in London. I said, Mr. Herrmann, he said, yes, yes. He said, I have this film I'd love you to try to do the music for. And he said, what's it about? It's called Taxi Driver. I don't do pictures of taxi drivers. I'm not that kind of film. I said, no, but you should just read. I don't know, it's in that kind of thing. You kids today. So, anyway, we sent the script. I met him in London. And I met him at a lunch. And he said, all right. He said, it was interesting. He said, he eats the cereal with peach brandy. He said, interesting character. And he said, it's all brass. The score is all brass, no strings. He said, it's all muscle, all strength. And he cued it. That was it. That was the picture.
To whom is the movie dedicated?
Well, to Bernard Herrmann, I believe the night that he finished the score. It was right day before Christmas. He died at the Universal Sheraton Hotel.
You have made a sort of specialty of backseat roles. Having shot De Niro at the end of Mean Streets, why did you choose to play the murderous, cuckolded husband in the back of De Niro's cab in Taxi Driver?
It had been planned for a friend of mine who unfortunately got into a terrible accident, so I got in the back. But the thing about it was that De Niro, I learned a probably pretty strong lesson in acting, and that I tell him, put the flag down. On the second take or third take, he said, listen, make me put the flag down. And that did it. That opened up the whole thing.
But in the finished film, he does not put it down until you really get upset.
Yeah.
He just sits there,
that's right,
looking at you.
That was the greatest lesson.
That's pure De Niro. Okay, here comes the stock company. Harvey was back.
Oh, yeah.
And where did you find that 12-year-old prostitute?
Oh, Jody. Yeah. And Jody Foster.
Certainly one of the most famous scenes in the recent history of American cinema is Travis in front of the mirror. And when Bob was here, we talked about it, of course. And I happen to know that in the screenplay, that entire scene consists of the following parenthesis. Travis looks in the mirror. That's all.
That's it, yeah.
How much of it was improvised by De Niro? How much did you offer him?
Well,
or did you just turn him loose?
Well, there was a problem. We were over schedule, and I said, we've got to get this scene in front of the mirror. I just know that you should be talking, though, in the mirror. You should say something. I just don't know what you should say. I said, well, I got to just try a few things. I don't know. Okay. And so he just stumbled on his own, excuse me, are you talking to me thing? And he repeated and repeated and repeated. I said, yeah, keep going.
You talking to me? You talking to me? You talking to me? Well, then who the hell else are you talking? You talking to me? Well, I'm the only one here. Who the fuck do you think you're talking to? Oh, yeah? Huh? Okay. Huh? Listen, you fuckers, you screwheads. Here is a man who would not take it anymore. Who would not let... Listen, you fuckers, you screwheads. Here is a man who would not take it anymore. A man who stood up against the scum, the cunts, the dogs, the filth, the shit. Here is someone who stood up.
I just kept saying, sounds good, keep going. And, you know, obviously I'm the only one here. All of that stuff came out of that. And then it was edited by, actually, Tom Rolfe, wonderful editor.
Beautiful.
Gave
editor.
It to him. I said, I chose some takes. He looked at it, he said, give me a few minutes, bang. He did it. I said, don't touch it.
Use a lot of overhead shots.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah.
You look worried. They're wonderful.
Well, first thing that comes to mind is Hitchcock. But I must say, I have to go back to what I said earlier, and that is seeing a lot of life from the third floor front. through the fire escape.
When he applies for the job, there's a shot from his point of view down on the table.
That's definitely the Lord, because he is the avenging angel. He's the one who's going to clean up everybody. He's going to set the world straight.
The film has a surprisingly gentle and idyllic ending. Sybil gets into the cab. He seems at peace.
I was a little nervous about it, but I did it, and it has a kind of Schrader's thing. He really feels that way about it, and it works, I think. I added one thing, and the very, very end, where he looks in the mirror twice and he focuses the mirror. And because I felt, in my mind, that a man like this, under the circumstances, crossing over the fantasy line and acting out.
Yeah.
I think he's going to do it again. I think it's just a matter of time.
So do I.
Yeah.
But for the moment, he's redeemed.
Yeah. Yeah.
How strongly do you believe in redemption?
Well, that's a good question, because I think ultimately it has to do with, and I would have to be careful with this sort of thing, but it has to do with the emphasis on Christianity in my mind. My experience has been maybe the dark side of it. And yet I know there's supposed to be a light. There's supposed to be a redemption. There's supposed to be something that that is uplifting, something that takes you out of yourself, and that I guess one would call a redemption. I don't know if I'm there. And that's what that Father Principe said when he saw a taxi driver. He said, well, I'm glad you ended it on Easter Sunday, not on Good Friday. And then ultimately told me there's too much Good Friday, not enough Easter Sunday in your films.
Really?
Yeah.
In 1976, Taxi Driver won the Golden Palm, the Cannes Film Festival. And 26 years later, at dinner on the closing night of the 2002 Cannes Film Festival, you and I made this date for tonight at the dinner.
Oh, that's right.
You have a long and important association with the Cannes Film Festival. You'd had a nomination for Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore. We won in 76.
I was very surprised, because I also thought that picture was a labor of love. It would never be shown.
God, what you felt when you saw The Seventh Seal, You just have to accept the fact that that's what many, many people have felt when they've seen Taxi Driver.
Behind them is a snippy maitre d' and a wilted Caesar. In front of them is a family drama playing itself out. But right now, life is perfect. Thanks to a full moon, a powerful engine, and the Autobahn-tested suspension of the Acura RL.
What was that? Yuck. This'll be cool. I can't wait.
Like Mike on DVD for your home. Available now at Target.
Don't tell anyone I said.
Was it a date?
And I'm wearing a pink linen jacket and white leather shoes.
Oh, no. Les jours et les nuits.
Yes, Patrick.
Yes, Patrick.
Occasions. One line always connects. Woodbridge by Robert Mondavi.
Financial security doesn't happen overnight. It's a matter of working hard to grow wealth and taking care over time to protect it. At Prudential Financial, we're experts in growing and protecting wealth. It's why 15 million people worldwide rely on us for financial solutions, for sound advice and planning, for help in meeting a lifetime of goals. Prudential Financial, growing and protecting your wealth.
I have an apology to make for knitting you a present rather than buying something you'd enjoy. I thought each present was a little piece of me, a person who, I'm now told, isn't very good at knitting. I'm sorry. This year, I'm shopping at Staples. You should, too. They have the exciting technology gifts everyone wants. And this month, you can get free delivery from Staples.com. But you can't get a macrame mouse pad.
Holiday shopping? Done at Staples.
This will be the best night of my life.
Montgomery Brogan is spending tonight with the people who matter the most.
Going to prison for 7 years.
But can you change your whole life in one night?
I'm going to be there when you get out. But you're not going to be there tomorrow. And it's all about tomorrow.
From directors Spike Lee, Edward Norton, Philip Seymour Hoffman, Barry Pepper, Rosario Dawson, Anna Paquin, Brian Cox.
Stay with me. Nah, I got to do one more little thing.
25th Hour, rated R. Starts Thursday, December 19th in New York and L.A.
It wasn't working, and Ridley came over to me and just whispered in my ear. He goes, close your mouth.
You see, now they don't look very fierce like this.
Rafe is my favorite leading man. He's exceedingly generous. It's his love scene. He's like, oh, what are we going to do here? How do we... I'll take my pants off.
Julianne Moore, Inside the Actor Studio, hosted by James Lipton. Questions and actors, next Sunday on Bravo.
With Mean Streets and Taxi Driver, Marty Serv noticed that something young, vital, and important was happening in American film. But he altered the landscape forever with Raging Bull. How did that remarkable movie come into being?
Raging Bull came out of De Niro. Quite honestly, I didn't know any sports, so I wasn't interested in Raging Bull in that sense, in boxing. He kept at me on that picture for a number of years, actually, until finally I was in the hospital and De Niro came up to visit me, and he was in the bed, and he said, why don't you just, he said, listen, you'd be good for this film. Why don't you just do it? Come on. And I suddenly said, yes. Mm-hmm. And I realized, I kind of found myself in the character, in a way. In what he was interested in, and what Bob De Niro was interested in, myself suddenly came together in my head through this man named Jake LaMotta, and this profession, quote unquote, of fighting, which means a guy's job, he gets up, he goes and hits people, they hit him back. He comes home, it's the same thing. The ring, the bedroom, the kitchen, it's the same. There's not, and it just becomes all of life. And so I understood that. And with that, I got out of the hospital, I was in much better shape. And he said, we're going down to an island and work on the script together. And again, I'm not that athletic. I don't like islands. I don't like trees and sand.
Sunshine. Water.
No. This guy took me down to this beautiful place in the island of St. Martin. And in the morning, we'd work on the scenes, and I'd different structure and dialogue and stuff. I'd put on audio tape, and then I'd write it up longhand, and then the person would type it up, and at night we'd read it, 10 pages, maybe 8 pages a day, and it took about 2 weeks. Jeez. And that was it. We came back with the script that basically didn't change.
I'm told by Bob that you had to schedule your film around his weight gain.
That was the key, yeah. That was the key. As he pointed out to me...
60 pounds.
Yeah, 60 pounds. We did the fight scenes first in Los Angeles. And then I decided that I don't want to do I don't want to do the thing from outside the ropes. The camera should be, again, like Travis, you should be in the person of the fighter himself. Therefore, you perceive the fight the way he perceives the fight. And what I decided to do was I storyboarded all the fight scenes based on a black and white video they did from one angle for me. And then we started shooting. We had scheduled 5 weeks for that in California. That took 10. And then we came back to New York to do about 10 weeks or 9 weeks of shooting of the dialogue scenes. And then we shot the last, the heavy Jake. We shot him in... L.A. and San Pedro doubling for Florida in less than 10 days around Christmas time.
God. All of this consumed how much time altogether?
I don't know. We started, but the whole thing altogether was 2 years, I think.
For me, one of the most interesting aspects of film is the way in which some directors and actors have become linked forever. Von Sternberg and Dietrich, William Wyler, Betty Davis, John Ford, John Wayne, mm-hmm. Hitchcock and his blonde goddesses,
sure.
Truffaut, Jean-Pierre Léo, and of course, Scorsese and De Niro. I was very curious when he was here, and I asked Bob, what happens when you and Marty work together. I'll ask you.
I find what's so great about actors, you know, they're like, they receive so much, and they have, it's almost like being, and particularly my relationship to De Niro, I think his, it's almost like being an open wound that could feel everything. The sensitivity is so strong. And I just happen to connect with that sensitivity. And there's a great privacy about that.
I'm told the two of you are very private together on the set.
Yeah, so in any event, he just understood a certain kind of relationship to life that, that I grew up with, and that had to do with the family.
Parents, did you remind each other of things?
Constantly. And did you notice when he moved that way? I noticed that too. That made him believe us. Yeah. And so there's a kind of immediate understanding that we almost thought the same way.
Who were you?
Was it my sister's?
Where'd you work today?
To the movies.
Yeah, what'd you see?
The father of the bride.
How come you didn't tell me about the Copa?
Tell you what about it?
You know. How come you didn't tell me about it? Why didn't you tell me about it, huh?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Why didn't you tell me, huh? Did you f*** my brother, huh?
Get off
Did
me,
you
fat pig!
Did you, huh?
No!
Open the door.
Get away!
Come on, open the door. I want to talk
Get
to you.
Get away from me, you're sick.
I just want to ask you one thing. Why did you f*** Joey?
Get away!
Open the door.
No.
Do you rehearse your films?
I like to, yeah. I like to rehearse them.
De Niro is well known for his meticulous and sometimes lengthy research. Do you research before you do a film? Do you do a lot of preparation apart from the storyboards?
Yes, yes.
It's well known that Marty brings to every film a cinematic scholarship that may be unmatched among film directors. How much do you use your clearly encyclopedic knowledge of movies and performances and directors
oh,
and stuff?
Oh, very much so, very much so. On Taxi Driver, Michael Chapman, I could say, Michael, Godard, two or three things I know about her. Remember the light, the colors? Oh, yeah, yeah, the yellow and the, yeah, yeah, okay. And it was a shorthand that way. There's one shot I just keep doing and doing and doing. It's a shot from Marnie. It's even in Gangs of New York. It's when she's, a horse gets hurt and she has to go shoot the horse. And there's a shot of the gun, her hand in the gun, and it's shot from here. That's her hand with the gun, and the shot from here, and she's running, but she's smooth. Obviously, she's not really running. Her hand is moving. It's almost in slow motion, and the grass is going this way. And often, if the filmmakers don't, or the people with me don't know, I get the piece and I show it to them. I do that a lot.
Your relationship with music is unique, I think. The film's titles are superimposed over a slow-mo of De Niro warming up in a mysterious kind of foggy ring.
Right.
Accompanied by one of the most haunting melodies in the operatic canon. Do you remember? What did you use?
Intermezzo by Mascagni. My uncles gave me that, my mother's brothers. That they gave me all that music.
From Cavalleria.
Cavalleria Rusticana, which has to do with Sicilian jealousy.
Who was your cinematographer on that film?
Michael Chapman.
Yeah. How do you work with your DP? When does he enter the picture?
As early as possible. I've been really lucky with Michael Chapman, Kent Wakeford on Mean Streets and Alice. Michael Ballhouse over about five films now.
Yeah.
They understand sometimes when I do this editing pattern or series of shots which are edited into a montage effect or tracking or whatever, they understand exactly, and they understood exactly how to get that. And they understood exactly the meaning of it that I was looking for. Or if I had a problem with it, they try to help me with that.
Do you rely on them to set up the shot, or do you ask?
No, the shot is usually designed.
It's designed. You've got your storyboard.
Yeah. Ballhouse actually transfers those notes into his own book, and then in the morning, one day, I'm arriving, and I'm depressed, and he goes, don't be depressed. Today, we do the shot that begins on the glasses and goes around to, oh, great, okay.
And you feel good.
Yeah, and you feel good. Okay.
Who was your editor on Raging Bull?
On Raging Bull, I got Thelma Schoonmaker to edit the film, and we've been editing every film since then.
Are you in the editing room with the editor?
Yes.
Every minute?
Every minute.
And what do you edit on?
A Lightwork computer. Yeah. That's since Casino. We've been doing it with Casino. It's faster. We used to work on the Chem flatbed.
Yeah, that was film.
Yeah, on film.
So you no longer use film?
No, no.
At the end of Raging Bull, this is what we see on the screen. So for the second time, the Pharisees summoned the man who had been blind and so forth. And the man replied, all I know is this. Once I was blind and now I can see. John 9:24-26. What's it telling us, Marty?
Well, during the post-production, Haig Menuhin died. And in a sense, everything that he didn't necessarily agree with the films I made, didn't like some things, but everything that I kind of learned from him, or at least was inspired from him, was put into the film. And it's about making judgment on other people, judging other people and saying that person is a bad person. They did this, they did this, they did this. How do we know if we're not in that person's place, we wouldn't do the same?
Yeah.
That's all, because I have a lot of people say about me over the years, and fine. The reality is, it's what I did. I can't run away from it. It's who I am. That's all. And what I am is up there on the screen.
What was that? Yuck. This'll be cool. I can't wait.
Says Fiasco written all over it.
Looking for adventure.
It feels like enough adventure for one day.
Get Stuart Little 2 on DVD for your home. Available now at Target.
I have an apology to make for knitting you a present rather than buying something you'd enjoy. I thought each present was a little piece of me, a person who, I'm now told, isn't very good at knitting. I'm sorry. This year, I'm shopping at Staples. You should, too. They have the exciting technology gifts everyone wants. And this month, you can get free delivery from Staples.com. But you can't get a macrame mouse pad.
Holiday shopping? Done at Staples.
Roll over your 401k?
Of course.
But it's not like you're gonna let it just sit there.
No, you're gonna push it and prod it and make demands on it.
Then you're going to put it in the hands of money managers
who won't give it a moment's rest.
Yeah, you're going to roll over your 401k.
You're just going to make sure it doesn't roll over and play dead.
Call a Fidelity retirement specialist to roll over your 401k. Because you're not just invested, you're personally invested.
For shoes at lunch.
Where'd you go?
Macy's, Caparo's, Nordstrom, Banana Republic, JCPenney, Eddie Bauer, L.L. Bean, and Neiman Marcus.
It's a cruel world.
Yahoo!
How do you, Yahoo?
How far can you go?
AT&T Broadband brings you the best television has to offer every month.
Pouches! A test of courage.
Give him back!
A young hero's journey.
Poachers.
Featuring new music by Paul Simon.
You will have your own challenges, and you will meet them splendidly.
I think so too, Dad.
Every month, look for the best television has to offer on AT&T Broadband.
Summer's here, and there's no better time to get in shape. Well, now you can with Fitness Made Simple's Summer Meltdown Special. Melt that fat away with our two best-selling videos, Fitness Made Simple and Six Pack Abs, hosted by fitness celebrity John Bastow.
The exercise routine, what to eat, it's all in these tapes.
I look like that 3 weeks before starting Fitness Made Simple, and this is me now.
Sold separately, each of these videos cost $29.95, but now you can get them both for $29.95. Order now to get this audio tape on the supplements free.
It wasn't working, and Ridley came over to me and just whispered in my ear, he goes, close your mouth.
You see, now they don't look very fierce like this.
Rafe is my favorite leading man. He's exceedingly generous. It's his love scene. He's like, oh, what are we going to do here? How do we... I'll take my pants off.
Julianne Moore, Inside the Actor Studio, hosted by James Lipton. Questions and actors, next Sunday on Bravo.
One of the most illuminating subjects of this series involves the criteria by which our guests choose their projects. What makes you say, this is something I have to do?
And character.
Character.
Yeah. The character and the situation the character's in. When you have a character that's pretty strong and is conflicted, and and hopefully obsessive, maybe a little paranoid. You can get into a very interesting thing, because you can get the script, you see, and you can work it in this world.
The Color of Money was one of your most successful films.
Yes.
What drew you to this picture?
Well, the possibility of working with Paul Newman.
Paul is the president of the Actors Studio. He's one of the creators of this drama school. And his portrayal of the mature Fast Eddie earned him his first acting Oscar.
Mm-hmm.
I want to know, what's it like to direct Paul Newman when he's at the peak of his powers, as he was in that movie, and he has been ever since?
Paul was. I've never really directed theater. And of course, Paul knows theater so well.
Yes.
Incredible. And so he taught me how to rehearse in a theatrical way. And that is actually get a hall and lay out. I mean, this may sound very elementary to a lot of people. I was, you know, I usually go to location and rehearse or, you know, and other things. But to actually lay out and have a chair and have a tape, so this is a chair, this is this, and actually work out the scenes and work out the rhythm and, if necessary, rewrites right there. We had the whole picture rehearsed within 2 or 3 weeks. And it was the only picture I did, but came in under budget, $1 million, and on one day under schedule.
I know that you began working on The Last Temptation of Christ in 1977. It's a very long gestation.
Yeah.
This film hinged on a thorny, no pun intended, question that was settled to the church's satisfaction by the Council of Chalcedon in 451 AD when they decided that Jesus was fully human
and fully divine
and that he was one person.
Well, it's the Kazantzakis book.
And yes, of course.
He understanding that if he's fully divine and fully human, his take on it was interesting in that he learns that he is Jesus, that he is fully divine. He learns by the end of the picture, and he has
only
to suffer.
At
the very, very end. And he has to suffer, like, as we all do in life, for many different degrees, and go through all the same things we do. Kids saying, well, if God is God and he dies on the cross, he's God, he knows he's going to live, so why is he suffering? He doesn't have anything to suffer. He doesn't understand us. Well, that's not the case. This one suffers from the very beginning and fights against it.
This is what Willem Dafoe said when he was in that chair about the experience of working on this film with Marty Scorsese.
I think he knew this movie, he had shot this movie in his head. I mean, he knew the shots. I can't tell you how low budget it was as far as timing. There was no fat on this. Mm-hmm. You'd put your stuff on and then you'd go and shoot. But he was ultimately the greatest actor's director in that he gave me such a beautiful setup and framed me so beautifully. Mm-hmm. And gave me everything to work with that I could not do any wrong.
I had designed all the shots back in 83, most of them, while I was waiting for, you know, to get a smaller budget and that sort of thing. And then finally it was canceled, around Christmas time for the second time. But I had designed it all. Harvey was involved with most of it in 83. And we had even scouted Morocco and Tunisia.
Where'd you wind up?
In Morocco.
When the guardian angel vanishes in fire, Jesus returns to the cross and says, it's been accomplished. It's clear that the past 20 minutes depicting Jesus' marriage, his children, has been a hallucination, a last temptation by Satan. Now that seems crystal clear. But given that narrative clarity, were you surprised by the religious condemnation that the
movie
evoked?
Yes, I was, actually. I was very surprised. I know the College of Cardinals in Rome condemned it, but the Pope never got to see it. So it was a very interesting situation because in a funny way, we never really even finished the film. We just had to get it out in the street. It had to do with faith and it had to do with a rethinking of a religious relationship to, in my mind at the time, to God and our society. And that's what I wanted to do. So therefore, don't worry about that if it's maybe too long at this point, just get it out there, let them see that this is what is on the screen, not what's in some old script that's circulating in the streets or in somebody else's mind.
In 1990, you gave us another stunning and seminal film. It was called Goodfellas. What made you decide it was your turn to enter what had been hallowed cinematic ground? This is ground that had been covered, and you entered it and did it brilliantly and succeeded, but it must have taken a moment of thought.
Well, it did. I think naturally I had entered it my own way in Mean Streets, And later on, there are aspects of Raging Bull.
Yes.
Aspects of it, but not
yes,
really, not entirely. And so I was not, I read a review of the book, actually, Nick Pileggi's book, and I thought it was wonderful because of the idea of the person, Henry Hill, being kind of a guide, like Virgil and Dante, taking you through all
yes.
the different levels of organized crime at that time. In a way, it's almost like a kids in the standing on a street corner, some tough kids telling you a story, where I grew up, which then leads sort of to stand-up,
mm-hmm.
in a way, and telling a story, but directly. And I decided to use voiceover like wall-to-wall. We designed the picture very clearly, very simply. Everything was there, even the freeze frames, the camera moves, everything on the page.
It's very evident tonight, obviously, that we are in the presence of a gentleman, a gentle man. You have never shied away from the moments of violence in your films. How do you feel about graphic violence in your own films and the films of others and in life?
I think the violence I had in my films, Mean Streets and certainly in Taxi Driver, and it was an emotional violence that I picked up on when I was growing up. And there was violence where I was growing up as part of everyday life. Violence is a very real and being part of being human. And the society, the place I came from, the way I saw it anyway, violence was certainly an option all the time. But I try to do it, I try not to make it, I don't know how to make it glamorous. So I just try to do it honestly.
Violence, no, Goodfellas is a visual tone poem. I think it's perhaps the most beautiful of all your films. Who is your art director?
Christy Zia.
And how do you work with your art director? How soon does that begin?
We did a lot of work on a lot of old family photographs of mine. My brother, my family, all of that sort of thing. And we took it down to certain places, the Lower East Side.
This is a very beautiful film. In Raging Bull, the title was Crimson.
Right.
In several of your films, including Goodfellas, the title is Crimson.
Mm.
You seem to have a special affection for red on the screen. Am I wrong?
I like it very much. I think it has to do, quite honestly, the use of red by certain filmmakers like Paul Pressburger in The Red Shoes, for example, extraordinary, and I saw it at the age of 10, stayed with me and burned it to my consciousness in a way.
There is a shot in this film that nobody will ever forget, of course, and that's the tracking shot.
On the Copacabana.
Into the Copacabana.
Yeah.
How long does that shot last? Do you remember? It is an unbroken shot, huh?
6 minutes.
Six minutes.
The idea was that the camera move has to be in one move because it's the height of his life, in a way. It's the height of his lifestyle.
And he's impressing the girl?
Yes, he's impressing her, yeah.
And he's free and unfettered for 6 minutes. He moves through the kitchen and into the club, and there's any young
money.
Women.
Yeah.
Perfect.
No, well, the thing about
shot.
It is that it's the idea of the shot. It's the philosophy of what's happening. What we're winding up now, and I have to be very careful. I keep thinking, well, I could design the shot. But why is it moving? Why is the shot moving now? It doesn't have to move. And because we have lighter cameras and we have all the stuff with digital, why are we doing it? It has no meaning. And I got to hold back now.
Right.
It's very interesting.
Once again, you cast your family.
Oh,
what did your mother play?
She played Joe Pesci's mother.
What a scene.
Yeah. Improvised, totally improvised. So we put two cameras down and they just hung on, you know.
This stuff is great, but it's like lint.
So tell me, where have you been? I haven't seen you. You haven't even called or anything. Where have you been?
Well, Mom, I've been working nights.
And?
Tonight we were out late. We took a ride out to the country and we hit one of those deers. That's where all the blood came from. I told you. Jimmy told you before, I won't say. Anyway, you know what reminds me? I need this knife. I'm gonna take this, it's okay?
Okay, yeah.
I just need it for
bring
a
it back, though, you know.
Well, the poor thing, you know, I hit him in his, we hit the deer in his paw, what do you call it?
The hoof.
The hoof got caught in the grill. Oh. I gotta hack it off.
Ooh.
Ma, it's a sin, you gotta leave it there, you know. So, anyway, I'll bring your knife back if they do that.
Anyway.
Delicious.
Thank you. Why don't you get yourself a nice girl?
I get a nice one almost every night, Ma.
Yeah, but get yourself a girl so you could settle down.
Settle down almost every night, but then in the morning I'm free. I love you. I want to be with you.
Did your father also play a part?
Yeah, he was a fellow with the cane. He's always been, actually, is one of the fellows who rubs out Joe Pesci.
This is another of your pictures that is cut to music.
Yes.
Cut to
all
one song
after
pop oldies. And do you pick the songs?
Or yes.
You do?
Always, all the time, yeah.
Stanislavski said music is the only direct way to the human heart. What are you trying to achieve with the scores of your movies? Is it to evoke something in us?
I think for me, music was the first, one of the first experiences, artistic experiences of appreciation that I had. Listening to those old 78s, from Django Reinhardt to the swing music, and then later to hearing Hank Williams, and that sort of thing. So I imagined so much from listening to music. Nothing that any film could create. My imagination just soared, and meant so much to me. A certain rhythm, a certain beat, a certain use of an instrument, or particularly a line of a lyric or two. And so, also, I feel that certain pieces of music reflect the world at that time. And there's sometimes a piece of music comes on, and it brings back this Proustian
instantly.
Yeah. I said, that's what I want to create.
Cape Fear marked your seventh collaboration with Robert De Niro. Bernard Herrmann's music again, even though he was dead.
Yeah, great. Elmer Bernstein took it.
Yeah, and used it.
And used it up, yeah.
The last 15 minutes of the film are very intense, to say the least.
That was a sequence I wanted to do. Spielberg and, actually, De Niro wanted me to do the film again. He just wanted to play Max. He said, I got to be Max. Spielberg was very, really wanted me to direct it. And I really tried to do an action sequence, and more of a commercial action sequence, to see if I, first of all, would enjoy the process, which when I'm shooting, I never enjoy it, but actually when I look back, I did enjoy it. And I drew every shot, basically, and then gave it to a storyboard artist, and we drew it. There were about 200 shots there. And it took, we were in a tent. We were in a some sort of a pit where we made all this water and I don't know, and tip tanks and the great Freddie Francis on camera, who did Elephant Man and all the extraordinary films of David Lynch, a lot of them. And it took about, I don't know, 6-7 weeks. It was slow moving because of the water.
We have the connection.
What do you think, Counselor? That was real eloquently. Brave, too. I want to thank you for conveying to me your very powerful emotions. Because I'm going to enjoy this all the more.
In The Age of Innocence, you directed an actress who has intrigued me for years. I have sometimes said that I suspect that her astonishing, perfect beauty may have obscured for some her exceptional acting talent. And that, of course, is Michelle Pfeiffer. I'd like to know what it was like to work with her.
Well, Michelle is, I had seen her in a number of pictures, particularly Married to the Mob, and I thought she was so good because I had a kind of a snobbery about sort of films made by Italian-Americans that are not Italian-American, et cetera, but like I could swear that she was right from who she was playing in that film. And I said, and at the end, the credits came up, and I said, it's Michelle Pfeiffer, I can't believe that. That's interesting. And I was really taken by that. So over the years, I watched her, and that was the only one that was in my mind that could play that part of Ellen. It was the only one.
She's wonderful.
Yeah, and just extraordinary.
Another of the themes in your film, I realized in this one finally, is food.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing pleases me more when I'm sitting in a movie then a wonderful shot of a delicious dish being prepared. I remember Paulie making the dinner in prison.
The garlic, cutting the
onions. Oh. You use food all the time.
Well, I think what it is that I'm also a history buff and an anthropology buff, so to speak. I really feel that what's interesting to me in Age of Innocence is the tribal aspect, that they behave a certain way, that in the upper classes, it's the less you say, it's a somber colors, you eat a certain way, you don't have dinner to eat and to fill yourself, it's a social obligation, and all of this, but without all that, they're still human, they have the same desires. It goes back to even the extraordinary historical film that Rossellini did, The Rise of Power of Louis XIV, which ends on the food, remember?
Hey, Charlie Chaplin ate his shoes.
Oh, yeah, that's the classic with the spaghetti for the straps, yeah. But food is, for me, it has to do with the anthropology of it.
To whom is The Age of Innocence dedicated, Marty?
Oh, to my father when he died, finally. And yeah, he saw, the last film he saw of ours was that in rough cut. And he was very moved by it, walked out. It's a very truthful film.
To listen to their music is to know their past.
It's just such a powerful force.
You don't have to be Irish.
Each note resonates with endless political strife.
People who did not grow up with the culture cannot understand that as well.
Every beat is rooted to the land. And in a world addicted to the new and now.
That's what's good about traditional music. It's music of today.
They've captured our imagination. Celtic Tides. Tuesday on Bravo.
My dream to realize this day. The day a father watched his daughter start at Juilliard. But I embraced that dream with unwavering attention and made it my own, because that was the dream of my client. And that's what I do at Morgan Stanley. One client at a time.
Tough heartburn slowing you down? Try Extra Strength Mylanta. Cooling relief that speeds right to where you need it. Nothing's faster. Extra Strength Mylanta. Soothing at the speed of life.
We all lead such busy lives. But there is a place where redwoods stand tall. And time flows slowly. Redwood Creek. Where the tradition of slowing down and taking time has never been forgotten. An unhurried approach to winemaking that leads to a richer, more full-bodied taste. Redwood Creek, because good things take time.
Hey, Fred.
Hey, Nancy. Can I help you find anything?
No, I'm good. Hi, Sue.
Hi. Sure you got enough room in that car?
She's got everything she needs to cook a homemade meal, including the chicken.
Mommy, can I?
Introducing Betty Crocker Complete Meals. All the best ingredients like flaky biscuits, steaming vegetables, creamy sauces, even juicy chunks of chicken in one box, ready to bake in 5 minutes.
Do you handle this?
Yeah, I do. Thanks.
New Betty Crocker Complete Meals. Make every day homemade.
The fate of the world will soon be decided. The dominion of evil grows even stronger. The peril of the Ring Bearer deepens. There is another who hunts the ring.
These are my people, and I shall die as one of them.
The Lord of the Rings, The Two Towers, rated PG-13, starts Wednesday.
With Casino, you return.
Oh, thank you. Look at guys. Thanks.
Who wrote it?
Nick Pileggi.
He also wrote Goodfellas, and you wrote with him.
Yes.
For our writers and our directors out here, when you're writing, how do you work with your collaborator?
It's a little different with each one. In the case of Goodfellas, Nick and I, we worked very closely together each day, 8 pages a day, let's say. We would work 7 or 8 pages or whatever.
Do you write things down in longhand?
Yes, longhand for me. Everybody else works on computers. I can't understand what they're doing. So in the case of Nick Pileggi...
That's because he's technically so deficient.
Right? Oh, I can't deal with those things.
When Sharon Stone was here, she talked about, of course, she got nominated for an Oscar for her performance, and she won the Golden Globe.
Golden Globe, yeah.
Best performance for an actress. I thought she was superb.
Yeah, me too.
She told us that when you were preparing her for the film, you gave her several films to look at in preparation for the role.
Yeah.
Valley of the Dolls, A Woman's Vengeance.
Oh, A Woman's Vengeance,
Jessica Tandy.
Based on The Gioconda Smile, Aldous Huxley.
And The Passion of Joan of Arc of Carl Dreyer.
Carl Dreyer's Joan of Arc, Falconetti's face. That's it.
In frame, that's it.
Yeah.
So are you with me on this?
You want to get rid of me?
Here I am. Go ahead, get rid of me. Hello?
I fucking hate you! Can't take it anymore! Yes, I want to kill you! I hate your fucking guts!
You hate my guts! I want you to come with me now! Come with me now! Come with me now! I want you out of here! You out of here!
Go!
I want you out of here! Take your f***ing money and get out of here.
I'll go, but I want my money right now!
Don't get your money. Don't worry.
The arrangement is over.
No kidding. No kidding!
And I still get my money. I need some cash right now. You can't just put me
I'll
in the street.
Cash. You know, you haven't been straight with me ever since I met you. You never even loved me in the first place. I need eyes in the back of my f***ing head with you, you f***ing bitch!
How can I love you? How can I love you?
Who are the directors who have most influenced you, Marty?
And while Cassavetes and Wells, definitely two sides of expressing themselves on camera. I loved a lot of John Ford films. Paul Pressburger, no doubt. Pasolini, Fellini, Rossellini a lot. The key ones I keep going. And Kazan was the main one. I would think in terms of learning about acting. I never went to an acting school or took any acting lessons or. I don't know how I deal with actors, but...
They keep winning Oscars.
Yeah, all I know is that when I saw... I was 12 years old and 13 years old when I saw On the Waterfront in East of Eden.
Yeah.
And those were the changes. Those were the changes.
Were you drawn to Kundun by its religious theme, its political theme, or both?
Both, in a way, I think. I think the world we're in now, especially in our society in America, we need input from other cultures, other religions, other way of thinking.
To whom is this film dedicated?
Oh, that was to my mother. Yeah, she passed away right after that.
Is it accurate to say that, in a sense, what we're witnessing over the years is your autobiography in film?
It's accurate. I mean, I don't know if I'm happy with that. I mean, I just don't see any other way of going about it, meaning that I don't know if that's a good thing. One's ego has to be dealt with when you make pictures, in a way. And each one is somewhat different. And if you put yourself too much in the foreground, you could destroy the film, what you're trying to say. So you have to be subject to what you're trying to express.
Yes, but many directors are more external to the process than you are. You seem to be deeply involved in it emotionally, psychologically, and thematically.
Well, I think that's what's developed over the years, particularly when I finally realized I could make a Raging Bull film. And that's where there was kind of a sadness. I said, well, then I don't know if I could really go off and do studio films, in a way. And so I had to make a choice. And I think a lot of that came from my exposure to Italian cinema and how it affected my family at the time.
When we met at the closing night of the Cannes Film Festival, you had shown 20 minutes of Gangs of New York. What is the genesis of this?
When I was doing Bringing Out the Dead, Mike Ovitz came to visit me and said, what would you really like to do again, the way he asked me with Last Temptation of Christ? And he said, what about that Gangs of New York you always wanted to do? And I said, yeah. He said, well, I'm forming a new company. Leonardo DiCaprio's in it. How about if we, you know, work it out? And so we did. And Joe Roth was involved at Disney, and ultimately Harvey Weinstein.
And who is in the film?
In the film is Leonardo DiCaprio playing Amsterdam, who's a young Irish-American immigrant. Cameron Diaz as Jenny, who's a young pickpocket in that area. And Daniel Day-Lewis as Bill the Butcher, based on a real man named Bill the Butcher.
It occurred to me that the question of class, whether it's class on the Lower East Side or class in New York City in the 1870s,
yeah,
is a matter of enormous interest and importance to you.
Yes, it is, and even in Gangs of New York.
Oh, I'm sure.
Because ultimately, in Gangs of New York, you're dealing with the
and
Five Points downtown.
Europe, bill cutting and slate of native
and you're dealing with
more of us
20 to 30 to 40,000 people crammed into that area, just got off the boats from Ireland.
Yeah.
There are Anglos there, and there are African Americans and freed slaves. And everybody's in different religions are living sort of like the Wild West, only claustrophobic. There were no wide open spaces, and everybody's on top of each other. And there was class distinction there too, very much so.
Yeah.
And so to the point that when the draft riots broke out in 1863, the first people that were attacked and killed were the Africans.
How is this film scored?
It's very important, the score in this picture, because there's a traditional score at times, but what happens is that we have music English, Irish, Scottish folk music that's blended ultimately with African rhythm. And African music is constant throughout.
Over here.
And
it
becomes, of course, American music.
Open it. Hold it up. Into the mirror.
That one.
Our queen has chosen.
What do you think you're doing?
I'm dancing.
I said, why'd you pick me?
That's none of your business.
Would you mind telling me?
Oh!
Sorry. Not much of a dancer.
Just try to keep calm.
I've never been to a step-in Ken before.
It's best not to look down. You can hold me tighter if you like.
Why didn't you dance with Johnny?
Because I didn't want him.
Gangs of New York, we did. A lot of Russian montage in the 1920s. And just gave it to the second unit directors, drew shots, and said, give me that. And Vic Armstrong was so, he does James Bond films, and he understood the different speeds of the camera. He said, well, if you want that to happen, I can do that at 48 or 36 or 120, and it was fantastic. I said, but it has to go from here to here, and it's got to cut to this, and just these little bits and pieces, putting together montage. Century in America was probably the most violent century in our history, the Civil War and the riots in the streets of Boston and Philadelphia and New York. And so a lot of this was, a lot of this action with the gangs was politically motivated and racist, very racist, very racist. And the Irish were considered anathema to these people. And it has to do with fathers and sons and the birth of a city.
I took the father. Now I'll take the son.
I come to say goodbye.
So I'll be finished tomorrow.
No, it won't.
Although it's been
said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
Yield to finding your glass more than half full. May the light and delicate layers of a Rocher always take you by surprise. Rocher, see what unfolds.
Surprise. And
many moods, many occasions. One line always connects. Woodbridge by Robert Mondavi.
This will be the best night of my life.
Montgomery Brogan is spending tonight with the people who matter the most.
Going to prison for 7 years.
But can you change your whole life in one night?
I'm going to be there when you get out, but you're not going to be there tomorrow. And it's all about tomorrow.
From director Spike Lee, Edward Norton, Philip Seymour Hoffman, Barry Pepper, Rosario Dawson, Anna Paquin, Brian Cox.
Stay with me.
No, I got to do one more little thing.
25th Hour, rated R. Starts Thursday, December 19th in New York and L.A.
Gather around here for some fun and good cheer and do it.
Go away.
Just wanna say,
go away.
A cool whip holiday.
Go away.
I'm cool with baby.
What? You're about to witness a graphic representation of what internet access is like with a dial-up connection. That took forever. Now, this is what high-speed internet access is like with a cable modem. Don't blink. It's fast. With a cable modem, there's never a busy signal. You're always connected. Plus, service is guaranteed. And most importantly, it's really, really fast.
Great moments are registered every day in Florida. See for yourself. And now, with all the discounts available on lodging, attractions, and fun, there's never been a better time to make some moments of your own. Great moments, great vacations, great values. Call today for your free Florida vacation guide. FLA USA.
Classroom session with the questionnaire by the great Bernard Pivot, who is the best person who ever did a job like the one that I try to do. I would like to ask you, in the spirit of Marcel Proust, what is your favorite word?
Well, I don't want to sound optimistic or anything, but I loved using the word wonderful. It has a kind of energy to it that means many different things to me and focuses right away and kind of spurs me on.
What is your least favorite word?
I was going to say time, but time is good. Slow. I like faster.
What turns you on?
Number of things, I guess, but the first thing is the enthusiasm of relating to with another person.
What turns you off?
Well, negativity. And I complain all the time. It's part of it. But then the complaint, the interesting thing is you have to get to the complaint. The complaint has to become absurd. And then you realize how absurd we all are and what we're doing. Like, what are we doing here anyway? I mean, in terms of being alive. So start with that absurdity. Now you move, and you're so now suddenly we're in a room, we got to come up with a scene. Okay, now that's, and it's the negativity. Oh, we can't do that because, in that case, let's not get out of bed.
Right. What sound or noise do you love?
Well, we have a 3-year-old now, and I like hearing her laugh and talk. I know it may sound corny to you guys, but it's amazing. Children.
Yeah. What sound or noise do you hate?
God, it's interesting. Living downtown Elizabeth Street, the streets were so noisy, and I don't know how we slept, but we were down there, all the different traffic and things. Now it's, I need a lot of quiet. But it's the very thing that gives you a kind of energy of the city that makes me love it and hate it and want to be nowhere else. I've lived in other cities. This is the only place for me.
What's your favorite curse word?
Oh, I can't. I feel too guilty. I'm too Catholic. I can't say.
Really?
Yeah, it's terrible. Oh, yeah. I think Joe Pesci could express it better. Mean Streets, when Mean Streets was shown at New York Film Festival, it was the first movie to use that way, right? Like this. And not that, I guess, an Esquire dubious achievement kind of thing, but Joe Pesci's use of it is very interesting and in how he is able to make it like music and break up syllables with it, you know? It's very interesting.
What profession other than yours would you like to attempt?
Well, it was music. It would have to be music.
Yeah. Do you play an instrument?
No, never did. Can't read music.
What profession would you not like to undertake?
Well, certainly one thing, not a studio head. That's for sure.
If heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
Oh, it's an interesting one. I think the trick is, I think God would be easier on me than I'm on myself. So maybe say, it's okay, come on in. Maybe. You know.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Here are your students. Come on in.
All right, kids.
Good evening. My name is Kosmin Kivu. I'm third-year director. You told us tonight about what inspired you and your work for the past 30 years or more. My question is, what inspires you today, and how is that different from the past?
There are some films from different countries that I like to watch. I mean, some of the younger filmmakers, new filmmakers. I was the president of the jury of the student films at Cannes this year, and to see the film, the prize winner, I think, was from Brazil. To see these films from all over the world was quite something, and see the point of view of the camera and how their people are relating and trying to tell stories. Usually, if you're shooting a film, too, and you only have a little bit of time on the weekend, you want to look at either, like, I like all kinds of films, so I'll maybe look at a horror film to just wake up. Just a little appetizer. Some horror, Italian horror film, or, you know. And then go back to something from 1960, 1950. But I watch a lot of foreign films as much as possible, some French, a few Italian. A lot of the new Italian films don't get here. But when I find that I have to go back to some source, I go back to the old films that I loved, or a piece of music, or reading.
Good evening, Mr. Scorsese. My name is Wayne Asbury. I'm a first-year actor. My question is concerning character development. How much time before filming starts do you devote to one-on-one character development, rehearsal-type setting, as you explained perhaps with Paul Newman, and could you talk about that process?
Well, I think it varies with each film, and I think in Mean Streets was something that came out of my own life, and my father and his brother and a number of other people. And so that was very clear. I mean, once the actors were involved, they knew from the page what was happening, and also from my discussions. In the case of Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, we had a wonderful, very good script by Robert Getchell, and we improvised some. We improvised certain scenes. But that was really working with Ellen Burstyn very carefully and closely several months before shooting started. Taxi Driver is Paul Schrader. Well, Schrader went through what he went through, and that's what came out. And that was it. There was hardly any change. I mean, there's some improvs. But there's nothing you could say or do. You just look at each other. The actor understands it. You can't today, there's the danger dealing with Hollywood or the studios is this danger of development. Well, I came out of the 70s where there was no such thing, where you had a script, or you may argue, make some changes, whatever, but basically they were backing that particular project. And if you got an actor, the actor was pretty much tied on to the project and went with what they was already there on the page, you know. In the case of New York, New York, I improvised to the point of actually changing the story so much that I couldn't shoot for like a week. We just ran out. I think what I learned was the control of the improvisation, the control that it starts here, goes from here, goes around there somewhere. Could come back here, but should be, got to get from there to there, next scene.
My name is Nelly Olmedo, and what qualities must an actor have to make you want to work with her or him?
A simplicity, maybe, and a sense of humor. But the simplicity has to be the kind of honesty that comes out of the actor, I think, you know? And it's funny, it's like, I never did acting classes, but I don't want to see acting, you know? Because I'm really a film person, in a way. Cinema, you could talk to the person's like this, and you get this great act. On the stage, you've got to project. It's a whole other thing. But I find that a simplicity, I think, in an actor, because the camera picks up so much, and with a great sense of humor. That's for me.
Good evening, Mr. Scorsese. My name is Patty Solner. I'm a third-year director. Can you share any secrets about how you communicate with actors to get such astounding performances out of them?
It's an interesting thing. What cinema is, or movies, you don't have to, doesn't necessarily to move the camera. The human face, the story being told by a person in the frame is the key thing, just completely. And if it isn't there, for me, I mean, for me, it doesn't work. It was a reassessment of that Rossellini's films when I did Raging Bull. Not the fight scenes, but all the other scenes were based on a kind of, simplicity. I look back now, I don't know if I see it now, I think it's simple, but I was thinking that way. There's no doubt about a formal simplicity, which I'd love to achieve. And I know to trust the actor in the frame, trust the person in the frame. They'll go with it if they're really into it, you know? I've been very lucky with the actors. The only acting I know is I saw the Kazan movies, but I didn't see them. I lived with them. I kept going from theater to theater. There were no videos at the time, right? So it was playing at another theater. I'd go see it. I'd see it again. I'd see it again. And Waterfront, East of Eden, I must have seen 10 times or so in all the different theaters. It was widescreen in color. It was James Dean. It was really the relationship with the brothers and the father that interested me. And I think in my other movies later on, you see that, it's particularly Raging Bull or Mean Streets. Even in Goodfellas to a certain extent, in Casino, it's all there. And I think I was at a certain age, 12 and 13 and 14, when I saw James Dean on a big screen in Color Boy with stereophonic sound. That it was devastating in East of Eden. He spoke for you. He spoke for you. And I wanted to achieve something like that because it was a kind of truth there, different from the Italian cinema in another way. But there was a kind of truth in the acting that I had never quite experienced before in a theater. In a cinema. And so everything I did was gauged according to Kazan's films. I never saw his plays to Waterfront and East of Eden, facing the crowd to a certain extent. The way he incorporated what we could term now the documentary in those pictures. He kind of discovered what to do with a camera like in Panic in the Streets, this film about the bubonic plague in a breakout of bubonic plague in New Orleans with Richard Widmark and Paul Douglas. Watch that one. That's on 20th Century Fox, 19. Jack Palance, Zira Mostel. It's quite extraordinary. He shot on real locations, and you can't tell who's a person from the place and who's the actor. And he was suddenly discovering what he can do away from the stage onto film. Wild River, Montgomery Clift, Lee Remick, and all the others in there. You'd see people in the frame that obviously are right from that place that they're making the film. And mixture of documentary, in a way, and hysterical drama, a kind of hysteria that was the life that I was around. I'm sorry. I mean, other people, it's too much, overdone. For me, that was life. That was normal. What they were doing in that film is normal. I saw it every day. Experienced it. I gauged it to that. I gauged it to, how I felt when I saw performances in those films and when I saw it in front of me with the camera. I saw it. Because I've always wanted to have, imagine if I made a film that has a scene as extraordinary as that just between Brando and Steiger in the back of the car. There are some moments, and it only comes through, I don't know what it is, it's a process, but the actor is the vessel, it comes through the actor. You know, and I've always, when I've been in doubt, I always went that way. And the one to free it even more and open it up another way was Cassavetes. So I had no real gauge dealing with actors. I've had actors, actually, you know what it is, I've had actors, lucky enough to have actors who felt the same way. And usually about the same films, the same influences. And we didn't say, well, let's do like this movie, but we both felt we were going for something. And they weren't, the number of the actors too, was very lucky. They weren't afraid of looking ugly. They weren't afraid of playing a scene on their back and letting the other actor have it. There was a kind of generosity which made me feel like it's about the final product. It's fantastic, these guys, you know? So I've been very lucky.
Now.
Next week, the Oscar-nominated star of Boogie Nights, Julianne Moore, goes inside the actor's studio with host James Lipton.